Welcome back, friends. Let us move on to our last but most important session of this one day seminar on GST. This most important session because so far you heard all about debits. The current session is talking about credit. So in this session, you are going to learn and understand input tax credit and transitional provision. To enlighten us on this subject, we have an eminent speaker, CA S. Vishnumurthy. Now I request CA Srinivas to come forward and welcome the speaker with a closed bowing. Friends, please welcome with a round of applause. Thank you, Srinivas. It is my pleasure to introduce the speaker to this August gathering. Mr. Vishnumurthy S. is a chartered accountant and also a law graduate. He has been in practice for over 30 years now. He is the proprietor of Vishnu Ram & Co. Chartered Accountants, Bangalore. He handles matters relating to income tax, VAT and service tax. He has participated in many conferences and forums in various capacities as presenter, speaker, panelist, etc. He is one of the core committee members for Advanced Refresher Course, a training session organized by Commercial Tax Department in collaboration with Fiscal Policy Institute in order to help the training officers in the field of post contract, interpretation of the law and life. He enjoys imparting his knowledge to young chartered accountants. With this brief introduction, let us once again welcome CA S. Vishnumurthy.
Saturday evening, from morning to till now, it has been GST, GST, GST. Recently, I was watching one ad released by Google targeting Apple. Apple has a 16 GB memory smartphone. The ad is like this. When you start videographing, suddenly you get a message, memory full. It doesn't happen in GST. I mean, it doesn't happen in Google. I don't know whether you have Apple memory or Google memory. Nevertheless, let me do what I am assigned to do. Before proceeding any further, let me take this opportunity to thank the Bangalore branch for giving me this opportunity. Topic is input tax credit under GST. What is missing in this title is it input tax credit available under GST or input tax credit that will be denied under GST? As you proceed further, you will notice this, it is all about denial of input tax credit. And before every denial, there is a story. So, some of the stories I have been able to, what shall I say, find out. Some of the stories I have not been able to. So, if anybody has a story behind this denials, you can come forward. Wherever it is not possible, even by this collaborative effort, let us say that is the rule of law and proceed further. I am a science graduate, having done what we call the chemistry, thereafter came to do CA. I had a friend from commerce stream. He undertook the responsibility of teaching and training me in accounts. We started with all seriousness and it was the first day of training. He was telling me how to pass an accounting entry for a transaction of sale. Debit, cash or bank or the party, credit sales. One question I asked, why do you credit sales? Don't ask me that. Sales means credit. So, wherever we are not not able to understand why it is so. Let us accept it. Just input tax. What do you understand when somebody says input tax? If you have to analyze this word, input is a short form for input goods. We are all busy people, so we don't have the time to say input goods, so we simply say inputs. Input tax means tax paid on input goods, goods that are coming. But that is not so. This is where the trick lies. Input, no doubt, refers to goods, whereas input tax need not necessarily refer to tax paid on goods. It would also refer to tax paid on services as well, input services. So while input refers to goods, input tax refers to tax paid on goods as well as services. Next is credit. We are all chartered accountants. We know in a balance sheet, asset side is debit, capital and liability side is credit. Where do we show this input tax credit? Asset side. It should have been input tax debit, right? Not input tax credit. Then why do we call it as input tax credit? We are looking at the government books. In their books, it is credit. That is why we call it as input tax credit. Under GST, all of you are very familiar with input tax credit under VAT, under excise duty, under service tax. Now we are looking at GST with little bit modifications and probably trying to take the best from the CELMAT credit scheme of excise and service tax as well as from VAT law. I was hearing Vadri, this was a copy and paste, not cut and paste, copy and paste from excise law. Therefore, he was telling there should be some mistake or something like that. When the intention was to get the best of both the worlds, sometimes things can go wrong and the worst of both the worlds can find a place. Like the very famous Bernard Shaw. I'm sure all of you must have heard about him. A very, 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 very intelligent man was approached by a very, 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 very beautiful lady. She said, "Mr. Shaw, you have such a wonderful brain and have such a celestial beauty. Don't you owe it to the entire world that we produce a child which will have your brains and my beauty?" Sure. Imagine if it happens the other way around. Sometimes it happens. Like in all acts, we have the first dictionary, right? Section 1 talks about the scope, commencement, extent, all that. Then we have the dictionary. So here also for our topic, let us see some relevant terms and try to understand. GST, GST, GST from morning till now we have been hearing. What actually is GST? Goods and services tax. Is it defined anywhere? How many statutes we are going to have? We don't still don't have. How many statutes we are going to have dealing with the GST? You can buy a lottery ticket, no problem.
30.
17. We have confusion about the number of statutes we have. What is the GST is all about? To provide revenue to the central government, to provide revenue to the state governments, right? How many state governments we have? GST Act to provide funding to the central government, and when so many states are there, there is every likelihood of states playing mischief. This is mine, this is mine, right? So to prevent that, we need to have one IGST. So number of states, that many number of GSTs, plus one CGST, plus one IGST. Now tell me, what is the total number of statutes we are going to have? Still we have not been able to resolve. Let us see when it comes to this. Now, GST, is it defined anywhere? What actually GST is about? Is it a tax on goods and services, or is it a tax only on goods, or rather it can be a tax only on goods, it can be a tax only on services, it need not be a tax only when there is goods and services? How is it? At least here, don't make an attempt to split that word. GST, it is just a word which is a word to indicate tax on supply of goods, and this is defined, or at least proposed to be defined, in the constitution. You may not find it anywhere in any of this number of statutes we are talking about. If you try to analyze it, you may get into trouble. It is like some lady calls up saying that I am Triloka Sundari, I want an appointment, when can I come and see you? After she keeps the phone down, you try to open the dictionary, Triloka Sundari. Don't get into that. GST, GST, Triloka Sundari, Triloka Sundari, just that, nothing beyond that. Aggregate turnover. Why do we need this concept of aggregate turnover? We understand turnover. Turnover today, it has got nothing to do with sales. It is the value of supplies, as Badri was explaining. It is politically correct to say that we help the small people. We cannot equate everybody. We will have to meet out a different kind of treatment to big people and small people. I think even amongst our profession, we may have some talk like that. Oh, that's a big firm. A small firm. That's a medium firm, if I'm right. How do you segregate these firms into big, small, or medium? Huh? Where is it mentioned turnover? I am certainly a big chartered accountant because I weigh 100 kgs. Right? Anybody has any doubt? So we must have a criteria to classify. So here, to classify or differentiate between big suppliers and small suppliers. Small suppliers means they will get some benefit. So there can always be some attempt to remain small when it comes to tax. I'm sure all of you will agree, right? When it comes to paying the taxes, I am a small man. So this aggregate turnover is that number which will differentiate a small supplier from a big supplier. Small suppliers need not pay tax. Let's understand that. That is a concession that is made available. What do you think should be a reasonable number for somebody to be called a small supplier? Just throw some numbers.
10 lakhs.
10 lakhs. Huh? Who said 10 lakhs? 10 lakhs. Is it a complete statement? I do 10 lakh supplies in Karnataka. I do 10 lakh supplies in Kerala. I do 10 lakh supplies in Telangana. I do 10 lakh supplies in Andhra Pradesh. How many states? I think we are still not resolved. Let us take it as 30. So, till my value doesn't cross 3 crores, want to say, I am still a small supplier?
Annually
only.
Now
you bring the concept. This aggregate turnover is with reference to your national. It is not with reference to any particular state. So aggregate is used in that sense to connote your overall turnover across the country. So if your aggregate turnover, that is turnover across all states, is going to be less than 10 lakhs, then you are a small time supplier. You need not pay the tax. Otherwise, you have to pay the tax. Capital goods. What do you mean by capital goods? Simple things. Normal goods. Either I consume them or I resell them. Only goods that I buy with an intention of using it for a long period of time, I call them capital goods. All of you are very familiar with this. But who told you that this is the definition? We are quite used to that, which has got some enduring benefit, blah, 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 blah. This is what we have learned in income tax. For GST, we have a separate understanding of this concept of capital goods. They give you a list, for example, machinery or items falling under Chapter 84 of Excise Tariff Act. So you don't have to have a definition. If the item falls under that list, like today we have in VAT, those who are handling VAT, capital goods as may be notified, serial number 20 of third schedule, then you have got a notification. Whatever items are there are capital goods, whether you are buying it for the purpose of reselling it or for using it for your business purposes on a continuous basis, nevertheless, they are capital goods. Enduring benefit, all those things become irrelevant. Here also, moment that item finds a place in that list, it becomes a capital goods. CGST, Central Goods and Services Tax, basically to provide revenue for the central government, and this is a tax that will be charged under Central Goods and Services Tax Act. Here is left blank because it is still not becoming an act. Next is important. E-cash ledger. What does that mean? E-cash ledger and e-credit ledger. E stands for what? All of you are very familiar. Electronic. Today, Government of India is planning to maintain books of accounts. That's a great news. And this is going to be electronically maintained. And the entire set is called Common Portal. E-cash ledger. Ledger normally contains more than one account. I think that is normally how we understand, right? So when we say e-cash ledger, this is the ledger maintained for a given supplier in that central, what portal? Common portal of GST. It contains cash ledger, means somebody may remit cash for discharge of his liabilities. It might be under local GST, it might be under CGST, it might be under IGST. For each of these enactments, there will be separate accounts. The cash remitted under these different acts will be captured in this e-cash ledger, but separate accounts will be maintained. E-credit ledger, that is the credit available to the supplier under different enactments. Again, ledger means for each state law, there will be a credit ledger. For CGST, there will be a credit ledger. For IGST, there will be a credit ledger. All of you use the word goods.
What are goods? Goods means what? It is defined there. Every kind of movable property other than money and actionable claims. What is movable? So you are saying what is not immovable is movable. Right? And what is immovable? What is not movable is immovable. General Clause Act defines what is immovable. Starts with the land, anything permanently attached to the land, anything that is fastened to that, something which is permanently attached to the land. We always had this problem. You know, there is a law which says whoever is the owner of the land is also the owner of anything that is permanently attached to the land. You have a site, you build a house on that, and you print a nice Graha Pravesha. What do you call it? Our house. That is, that building is ours. How do you say that building is yours? You don't have a sale deed for the building, you have a sale deed for the land. But still, how do you say building is yours? By applying this law. If the land is yours, anything permanently attached to the land is also yours. I don't know how many of you have heard about this great story. You know, we had Dwapara Yuga and we had now Kali Yuga. In Dwapara Yuga, people were very honest, virtuous, all that kind of thing. It was the last day of Dwapara Yuga. From the following day, it was going to be Kali Yuga. There were two good neighbors, very nice neighbors. I don't know whether they were nice because they were living in Dwapara Yuga. You will see little later. There was a coconut tree in A's plot. It had coconut. One fine evening, unfortunately, one coconut fell and the tree was slightly bent. So coconut fell into the compound of his neighbor. So the neighbor picked up that coconut, brought to this fellow, "Sir, it has fallen from your tree, please take it." What will this fellow say? No, it has fallen into your compound, so you must keep it. A big fight ensues. And it was quite late in the night. Then they decide, let us resolve this tomorrow. Let us keep this coconut on this compound wall. Tomorrow morning, let's resolve this. The next day is what? Kaliyuga. The person comes, "It is from my tree. It is my coconut. No, it has fallen into my compound. It is my coconut." Now the problem is posed to you. How do you resolve this problem? Whom does that coconut actually belong? If you were to apply whatever law is there today. Land belongs to whom? Where the tree was there? Yeah. Tree is what? Something permanently fastened to the land. So tree also belongs to him. This coconut was permanently attached. Unfortunately, it fell down. That would also belong to him. You can read the judgment. So goods means movable property. Very interesting thing for GST. Under VAT law, you had this IPR. You know what is IPR? What is there inside which we can't see? Intellectual property, right? Was it a goods earlier? Or rather, is it a goods today? It is something which is not immovable. Do you agree?
Yes.
It need not move. Somebody was trying to say it is something which can be moved. No. If something is not immovable, it is movable. If something is movable, it is goods. IPRs are not immovable. You agree?
Yes.
Therefore they are movable. Therefore they are goods. Agree? This is what is the position today. Today in GST there is a very very specific provision to say that intangible goods are services. They are not goods. What is intangible? You should actually appreciate GST because these are all defined terms. Intangible means something which can be touched and felt. IPR, can you touch it? Can you feel it? You can't. Therefore, it is intangible, and if something is intangible, it is not goods. What about electricity? Can you touch it? You can't touch it because you can't see it. But can you feel it? IGST, tax under Integrated Goods and Services Act. Why do we have IGST at all? Very valid question. Why do we have IGST? We need to feed only two, or I mean, at least state government and central government. What is this IGST doing here? I think you must have had a session about place of supply of goods, place of supply of services. You have intrastate supply, you have interstate supply. Intrastate supply means what? Within the state. When do you say a supply is within the state? If the supplier is in a given state and if the supply is effected in the same state, then you call it as intrastate supply. Now, this is the definition that we know. Where do you find this definition? This definition you will find it in IGST. The purpose is very simple. State government is very keen to tax almost all the transactions. By stretching the law or making modification, they can bring all kinds of supplies and treat them as intrastate supplies. All that is required, if the supplier is within Karnataka, it is an intrastate supply in Karnataka, they can make a law. If the goods that are supplied are in the state of Karnataka, it will be an intrastate supply. Tamil Nadu will also make similar law. Then every state will try to tax this kind of a thing. That is why a mediator steps in, called the parliament. The authority to make that law is given to them. So they make a law which will be followed by all other states. Thereby this multiplicity or mischief of taxing is avoided. This is one of the main purposes of having a IGST or Integrated Goods and Services Tax Act. Today we have CST. CST's only purpose is that central government doesn't get any revenue out of CST. Inputs ESOP, IST, Input Service Distributor. We'll see something about it little later. Input tax also we saw. It is IGST or CGST or SGST. Collectively we call them as GST. Charge on any supply of goods and or services for business. One of the denial has started here. Business. We are quite used to this famous thing. What is the big promise that is made? Whatever taxes you have paid earlier will be allowed to be set off against the tax payable by you. Now I am bringing first restriction. Only if you have purchased the inputs for the purposes of business, I will give you ITC, input tax credit. Otherwise, I will not give. ITC, not company which makes cigarettes. It is input tax credit. Inward supply. Supply, when somebody says, it is outward supply. So distinguish outward supply from the receipt of goods. We are going to use inward supplies. Job work is again an important area. Undertaking any treatment or process on goods belonging to another. Job worker doesn't sell any goods. He only receives the goods, or he gets inward supply of the goods, and after doing the job work, he supplies it back. Today, under GST, the taxable event is not sale but supply. Imagine a situation, if you are sending the goods to a job worker for doing the job work, is it not a supply? Should it not be subjected to tax? After doing the job worker will send back the goods. Is it not a supply made by him? Why do you say it is not a supply made by him? Supply, giving the goods to somebody, it is not transferring the ownership. So it is a supply. Even the job worker will have to pay the tax. So we have made a general rule like this, on every supply there will be a tax. But that is going to hit hard for job work categories. Therefore, for the limited purpose of job work, these transactions are defined as not supplies. The downside for this, moment you say it is not a supply, the person when he sends the goods to the job worker, he doesn't pay tax. What happens to GST that he has paid on those goods? Somebody, departmental official, can say, hey, you have used these goods for a non-taxable transaction, I will not give you ITC. Therefore, we have a special rule for job work. Even though no tax is payable on such transactions, nevertheless, the person sending the goods will be eligible for input tax. Zero rated supply. What is the zero rated supply? When supplies are exempt, no tax is payable. If the supplies are zero rated, then also no tax is payable. If I had kept quiet by saying that exports are exempted, then the ITC on the inputs which are exported would not have been available. Exports need to be encouraged. Therefore, I don't call exports as exempted. I say they are not exempted or they are taxable, but the tax that is payable on them is to be calculated at 0%. Effectively means no tax. But the brighter side is you will be eligible for all the input tax. Now that we are in exports, let me ask, what do you mean by export? Just to give you an example, Ashoka, now it is called Lalit Ashok, will sell food packets to Emirates flight to be served to the passengers on board. Can we call it as export? Can we call it as export? Why?
Because the place of supply is within
India.
Place of supply? Is within India. Airports are not export zones.
But the export definition is goods are taken out of India. Are they taken out of India?
But the moment you have supplied there, these are consumables.
That way there can never be any export. There can never be any export. Even when you are delivering the goods to a ship to be sent abroad, supply is taking place in India. But won't you agree that they are exports?
But how will you ensure that these are not consumed at the airport?
You must
be, I can eat at the airport, right?
I will take you inside the aircraft and I will show you, I will start serving. Then you will accept it is export?
No, sir, there is always, it is subject to litigation. Because I don't know where will I consume it. I will consume it in the
anyhow, the point is not that, it is not where you consume. The taking it out of India, it doesn't stop there. It should be taken out of India to a definite place outside India. Whereas these articles of food are not taken to any definite place outside India. Like you said, you may decide to eat in the airport itself. It's a different matter, the crew might object. But nevertheless, you may start. Somebody may wait for some more time. So, the reason because of which it is an export is that there is no definite place for those supplies. There is no definite place outside India for those supplies, therefore they will not be exposed. Exempt supply, which is by notification or otherwise exempted. Now you saw the definition, if you have watched closely, there was one item which is neither goods nor services. Which is that? Can you visualize any item which is neither goods nor service?
Money.
Money. Exactly. Money is neither goods nor services. So that truck, whatever you have been seeing during the Tamil Nadu election, some 570 crores were being transported in those three trucks. On the freight charges, there will not be any GST. Now, what are the benefits of GST? Creation of a common national market. I think headline newspapers screen this kind of headlines. Put it very simply, a Ashok Leyland, let us say. It has got a truck manufacturing facility in Hosur, which is in Tamil Nadu. They want to procure some components or parts for manufacturing the truck. There are suppliers in Hosur or maybe in Chennai, and there are suppliers in Bangalore. Today, what is the position? If he procures it from Bangalore, what happens? The Bangalore supplier will charge him 2% CST. And what happens to that 2% CST? It becomes his cost. So, this enters into his decision making process. Right? Moving to GST, what will happen? It will not be 2%, it could be 18%, whatever we are talking. Moment this supplier from Bangalore supplies him this parts, he will charge him 18%, let us say. IGST, because two states are involved in this transaction. Now, Ashok Leyland has the credit of this IGST, which can be set off against the GST. It could be CGST or SGST that is payable in Tamil Nadu. Now, suddenly, in that decision making process, tax becomes irrelevant. If you procure that materials from Tamil Nadu, again there will be same taxes. Whether he procures from Bangalore or from Hosur, it doesn't make a difference. It becomes location neutral. So, this is how a national market. I just gave you an example, Bangalore, Hosur. It could be the same story if he is produced from Bombay or if he is produced from Delhi. Freight, that's a different matter altogether. But as far as taxes are concerned, that is not going to make a difference. There is free movement of ITC from Karnataka to Tamil Nadu. So, BD Shetty can read it a little carefully. Our Bangalore branch, suddenly they decide to become very generous. They want to gift us Titan watches by procuring them directly from Titan factory in Hosur. Today, if they were to buy, what happens? They can't, and I'm sure they won't issue C form, right? when they buy the watches, they won't issue because it is not meant for sale. So Titan Factory in Hosur will charge full tax. This tax will go to whom?
Tamil Nadu.
Tamil Nadu. You feel very bad, right? Come GST, Tamil Nadu will be asked to transfer that amount from Tamil Nadu to Karnataka, because ultimately that goods will be used in Karnataka. Therefore, Karnataka government can get that taxes. Something which you need to consider very seriously. So this is how they say in GST, it is a consumption-based and destination-based tax. The ultimate tax revenue will go to that state where that ultimate consumer is situated. Today, we have this source state concept, we have this destination state concept. When I was giving the example of Ashoka Leyland, Karnataka was the source state, and source state had to be given some amount. It might be just 2% GST, but nevertheless, there was an obligation to pay something to the state government of Karnataka, that is the source state. And the rest of the tax we would have gone to Tamil Nadu. In GST, money will go only to the consumption state. GST will ensure that tax incidence is only on value addition. Today, you pay VAT after adding the excise duty. The base for calculating your VAT is after adding the excise duty. So actually there is tax on tax, or there is, what is that famous thing, cascading effect. GST will remove it completely. Ultimately the consumer will pay tax only on the value addition. Nothing more, nothing less. Cross utilization ITC. Today, I have given a Louis Vuitton showroom in UB City. They pay rent. On the rent, they are required to pay service tax. No doubt there is semi credit of service tax, but it will be denied for the simple reason the place is used only for effecting sale of goods. So the service tax that is paid becomes a cost. Come GST, that service tax, in fact, no longer remain as service tax. When they pay the rent, the landlord will charge them GST, CGST plus SGST, and that will be available to be set off against the CGST and SGST payable on the goods that they are going to sell. So cross-utilization of these credits are permissible. Seamless transfer, I told you earlier. In today's scenario, whenever there is movement of goods from one state to another, both source state and destination state will have to be paid some taxes. Come GST, nothing of that sort. The source state will collect the tax but hand it over to the destination state without retaining anything. Maintenance of transparent accounts records by the government. Hopefully something like 26AS will be available to us in GST. It is not a tall order. It may be a reality. B2B supplies and B2C supplies. B2B is business to business. A Bollywood actress, let us take Deepika Padukone, decides to get married. Naturally, she will be procuring goods, services, maybe makeup artist, blah blah, whatever. They will charge her GST. Is it immaterial whether she is a famous actress or whatever it is? She procures service which will suffer GST. Now, whether this GST will qualify as ITC in her hands. Now, I think for some movie, Padmavati or so, She has been offered some 11 crores as a fees, on which she has to pay 15% service tax. So we might get moved over to 17, that time she may have to pay GST. Whether she will be able to set it off. She would have paid GST on all the supplies. Whether she can set off ITC of that GST, what she is going to pay to the suppliers of food and services, again the GST payable?
No.
Not possible. Why do you say no?
Not for business.
Not for business purposes. Today, definition of business. How many chartered accountants hate the word business? If somebody says, so you are doing business. No.
Professional.
Today, unfortunately, GST doesn't recognize that kind of a distinction. Business includes profession. Now, I will give you a small twist. She sells the videography rights to somebody, videography rights of her marriage to somebody. Then what happens? Celebrity videography, it's a big business, right? She will get paid for that. Do you think she will get ITC now? Why?
She is not marrying
for such a very, very valid point. There is a word that is used. When you obtain any services or goods with an intention of using it in the course of business, that is one part, or which are used in the course of any business or for further business. Do you have any dispute that it is used? Intention may not be there. Like you rightly said, she didn't get married because somebody will take the photos. No. But in reality, somebody is paying her money. This is just to give you an idea. One is the denial part. Second, how this ITC regime gets amended, distorted. It is a game that is being played. When they say they will do like this, we try to say we will do like this. When they say Deepika Padukone will not be eligible for ITC, somebody will suggest you sell videography rights to somebody. It could be a small amount, doesn't matter. But we will argue, saying that that services are used for. Then one more amendment. That is why if you read the model law, every, I cannot even use the word section, probably today it's a clause, say subject to such conditions, restrictions or rules as may be prescribed. Because they do not really don't trust you. They are all the time scared where you will try to take them for a ride. So they want to reserve that right. If you do like this, we will do like this. So the first denial happens because it is not used for the purpose of business. A jeweler purchases a jewelry, but they get stolen. What about the ITC? Why do you deny? This is not bad law. This is GST. Today, when you procured it, what was your intention? To use it in the course of business, not to get it stolen. No deal. Straightforward. Right? So, why ITC should not be given? And losing, it's part of the business, right? Of course. That is why I take insurance. It is anticipated, otherwise why will I take insurance?
But he has not supplied to the thieves, right?
He supplied to the thieves, yes. But there is no consideration, no tax or you don't give.
He even supplied.
At the request or otherwise of the owner of the goods, if the goods go into somebody else's hand, it will be treated as supply for the purpose of this act. This is the next amendment you can go. You are an antique dealer and you bring your personal antique items into your business. Are you eligible for ITC? This is a case you are not started. You have some antique items left behind by your parents or grandparents, whatever it is. Now you have started. You bring some items from home. Fortunately, you have the tax invoice and all those items for that antique. Are you eligible? This distinction, actually used and intention to use, need to be looked at very carefully. Here is a case, those antiques are actually used in the carrying of business. Why ITC should be denied? You exchange your old personal jewelry for new personal jewelry. Straightforward case of what? No ITC. There is no business. You, a chartered accountant, invite Shah Rukh Khan, big auditor, for inaugurating your office. Shah Rukh Khan won't come free. Appearance fee will be there. On that there will be GST. Are you entitled for ITC of that GST? Furtherance of business. First you should admit that I am doing business. Furtherance of business. A supplies crackers in Malleshwaram ground during Diwali. Only for a week. Rain permitting. Otherwise it could be for a day or two also. I procure the crackers from Shiv Kashi by paying GST. Am I eligible for ITC? Yes. So, for how long you have carried on the business? Yeah. If a company wants to close its operations in Bangalore, it releases an advertisement inviting offers to purchase its business. Advertiser will charge GST. Am I eligible for ITC of that amount? What do you mean by in the course of? You have got a commencement, you have got a closure, right? This is in the course of winding up of the business. It is not in the course of carrying on of the business. Do you agree? See the distinction? Business includes any activity for closing of business. That is the definition of business. So this will be in the course of carrying on a business. Agreed? So you are eligible. Some places they are very gracious. A company wants to set up its operations in Bangalore. It has not yet. It releases an advertisement inviting offers for rental space, executives, etc. Will they get it? Any operations in the course of commencement of business is also in the course of business, therefore you are eligible. Bangalore club engages a chartered accountant to audit its accounts. Big auditor, because its aggregate turnover is going to be more than 10 lakhs, he will charge a GST. So whether Bangalore club will be eligible for ITC? Are they doing any business? Are they liable to pay any tax on their supplies to members? Will mutuality come into play there? Whether the members and the club are treated as different persons? In income tax you have this famous mutuality concept, no? I cannot be rendering services to myself. What do you think? Very specifically, I said all these kind of associations are treated as persons different from its members. And any supply, be it services or goods, by this club to its members is considered as a business. So this chartered accountant service is used in the course of business, therefore it is eligible. Next, ID is available only to registered taxable persons. There are two things: it should be registered, it should be taxable person. Now we saw some time back, if somebody's aggregate turnover is less than 10 lakhs, we treat him as small and we give him the benefit, you don't pay any tax. Now, should I wait till he crosses 10 lakhs or should I tell him to get himself registered moment he crosses 9 lakhs? Some gap should be left, right? So, the law says moment his turnover crosses 9 lakhs, he has to obtain registration. However, he need to pay tax only when his turnover exceeds 10 lakhs. This is the first part. Now, when he gets registered, there will be some stock in his hands, and if he is a small time manufacturer, there could be finished, semi-finished, raw materials, lot of items will be there, on which he would have paid GST. What happens to such GST? Should he get or should he not get? And if he should be given, how would you compute it? Should it be given from the based on the stock that is available on the date he applied for the registration, or based on the date from which he becomes liable for registration? You should really appreciate they have made the law very, very clear in this regard. Even though he obtains a registration soon after touching a turnover of 9 lakhs, he need not pay any tax after that. His liability to pay tax arises only after he crosses 10 lakhs. That is the first part. Therefore, on the day his turnover crosses 10 lakhs, that is the day on which he becomes liable to pay the tax, you find out what is the stock that he has. It could be in the form of raw materials, semi-finished, whatever it is. On that, what is the GST that he has paid to the suppliers? Now again, an issue might arise. Naturally, we are very good at complicating. Should I take it on LIFO basis or FIFO basis? We may have a problem, right? They have answered it by saying generally accepted accounting principles. Both are companies. But it should be followed consistently. Now, this goods what is lying in my stock on that day might have been purchased about 2 years back. Should he be given the ATC? There has to be some cutoff period. If 2 years is fine, why not 10 years? So the law says if it is not more than 12 months old, you are eligible. So denial story is if it is more than 12 months, you will not be available. The company procures fertilizer for its coffee plantation. Let us take the example of Tata Coffee. Whether growing coffee is a business? Yes. Agricultural operation. Law very specifically says, this is thanks to one of the Karnataka High Court judgment in Malanur estate, it is not a business. Moment it is not a business, any inputs procured for using in that will not qualify. Therefore, they will not get ITC of the GST paid on that fertilizer. A supplier with aggregate turnover of 50 crores has not obtained registration. We call such people as suppliers who are liable to be registered. When that liability to register arises, moment somebody's aggregate turnover crosses 10 lakhs. Here is a case where his turnover is 50 crores, he has not obtained registration, he is classified as a person who is liable to be registered. A person who is liable to be registered but who has not obtained registration will not get ITC of the goods that are lying with him when he obtains registration. That is a punishment meted out to him. Even CEO is paid salary of rupees 12 crores. His CA charges him fees of rupees 10 lakhs for his IT matters. Will the CEO get ITC of the GST charged by the
CA. The law very specifically says salaried person, employees are not taxable person. ITC is available only for taxable persons. So employees are treated as not taxable person. Moment he is a non-taxable person, ITC is simply not available. Whether currency printing company will get ITC? Mudranalaya. It is not that everybody can start their business. Because they are non-taxable items what they are printing, they will not get ITC. Transition from unregistered to registered category, we just now saw this. Composition supplier. What is composition? All of you are aware, it's an agreement. Instead of paying it taxes as prescribed under the normal scheme, an agreement is entered into between the supplier and the government, where the government says you don't follow all these kind of things, you simply pay 1% of the total value of your supplies. That is what the state government will say. Similarly, central government will say you pay 1% to us. So state government 1%, central government 1% of the total value. Like I said, it is an agreement which will contain terms and conditions. What is one of the conditions there? You should not take any ITC. So a composition dealer, a composition supplier will not be eligible for any ITC. At the same time, there is a provision which says that a person whose aggregate turnover crosses 50 lakhs will not be eligible for that scheme. So moment his turnover crosses 50 lakhs, he has to come under the normal scheme. When he transits from the composition scheme to the normal scheme, there might be goods lying in his possession. Same story like this, unregistered dealer becoming a registered dealer. Find out, based on the normally accounting principles, what are all the goods that are there, what is the ITC paid on them, that will be available. Rather, what is the GST paid on it, that will be available as ITC. Now, this 10 lakhs business is a voluntary thing. If somebody wants to pay tax right from the first rupee, he is allowed. Because what happens is, if there is no such provision for voluntary registration, many people may not go to him to buy the goods, because he is not going to charge GST. If he doesn't charge, then this person who is procuring it will not get ITC. Therefore, there is a provision which allows even a small time supplier to obtain registration voluntarily, even though by law they are not required. In such cases, he becomes eligible for ITC on all his purchases. ITC and mixed use. A businessman purchases New Year gifts and distributes it to his customers as well as his relatives. What happens to the ITC? Available on what? On both? We are talking about a denial story.
Customers
is available, and whatever is given to relatives, ITC attributable to that is not available. How do you compute that is very easy to say. How do you, because you have purchased it in one lot. Central government will provide you the rules. Rented premises used for office purposes as well as residence purposes. On the rent, you will pay GST. What happens to the GST that is attributable to that portion which you have used it as residence? Personal use, right? It is not a business use. That will not be available. So how do you do that? How do you do the bifurcation? Again, they will provide the use. First contract. What is first contract?
Good. Goods should be consumed as part of service provided. transfer of property takes place.
Normally understood, works contract means a contract where there will be supply of goods as well as services. That is what normally for GST purposes, in the first place, they have declared works contracted works contract as a service. That is the first thing. Second, it need not involve goods. It can be a contract only for doing some work which may be in the form of service also. In a joint development, what happens is that works contract is entered into for the purpose of creating an immovable property. Somehow there is something against this immovable property. Any inputs or services used for creating immovable property will not be considered as a qualifying input or as a qualifying service unless you are doing it as a developer for somebody else. Basically, you should not be come to own the immovable property after the first contract. You should go to somebody else. What happens is, I am a main contractor. There is a land, what shall I say, I am a contractor. I do contract for another main contractor. I do the works contract for him. He does it to the landlord. Then from me, the goods will go to him. From him, the goods will go to the landlord. So whatever GST that I charge that main contractor, that is actually used by him for charging further GST to the landlord. In such cases, IDC will be allowed, otherwise it will be denied. Special cases. This is for restructuring and such other activities. We saw in the beginning, IDC is an asset, or at least it is a debit balance. Which one you will agree, IDC is an asset or a debit balance? Asset means always something which can be encashed. IDC is not possible to encash in that sense. You can never claim refund of IDC. It has to be used only for setting off your GST liability. Now, when a company which is having this IDC merges with another company, whether the government will allow this transferor company to transfer the ITC credit to the transferee company, that is the question. All assets will go under the scheme. If you consider ITC as an asset, that will also go. On the other hand, if you think ITC is not an asset, then it cannot go. Even if it goes under your scheme, whether the department will accept it as a ITC in the hands of the transferring company? Law is very clear. In the case of restructuring exercises like this, it may be a sale of entire business where the transferor goes out of business after that. In such cases, ITC can be transferred by one person to another person. Why they are very, very, what shall I say, strict about not allowing transfer of IDC by one person to another person? We'll see probably little later. Because you cannot get a refund of IDC from the government. If IDC is allowed to be transferred by me to him, I am literally encashing that IDC which the government doesn't allow me to do. I take money, it is like, you know, credit card. Normally, I am supposed to use it to discharge some obligation to pay for the merchandise. But I go to the shop and tell them, you know, you charge one slip and give me the cash. Many people do that also. It's possible, right? Yeah? If chartered account purchases a new car, will he get ITC? Whether he uses it for his business or morning I will drop my son to school, afternoon I will drop my wife to club, in between I will take it to income tax office. How do you go about allocating or identity proportionate?
Percentage.
Too complicated, right? So simple, for car, no ITC. Very special item. For car, you will not get ITC unless a supplier like Mandovi Motors, for example. Mandovi will buy the cars from Maruti Udyog and then sell it to you. It is very unfair to deny the ITC to Mandovi Motors, really. There it is allowed. A caterer, he purchases a van or whatever it is for catering. It's fair that he should be given. For transporting passengers, he should be given. So in all those cases, they will allow. In other cases, car has been given a very special status. It is not that it is a capital goods, nothing of that sort. Car, motor vehicle, not only car, any motor vehicle. It is considered as a, what shall I say, something on which I do not allow you ITC. Like I told you, don't ask me why. Car, no ITC.
Commercial vehicle.
No, factory purpose means what? To transport the factory? Transportation of goods?
Yes.
Allowed. Transportation of your workers?
May not be falling part of capital goods definition.
Beg your pardon?
May not
be
part of capital goods definition.
Capital goods means I have a list.
It is not there.
Because sometimes it is an input. Like I told you for Mandovi Motors, it is input goods.
Other than that, it is not
a capital goods because it is not there in the list. Because it is not there in the list, you may tell the officer it is not a capital goods, therefore it is an input. Therefore, give me ITC. Goods should either fall under inputs or under capital goods. One of the two categories. It is not a capital goods you are admitting. Therefore, it is inputs. If it is inputs, give me ITC. Therefore, I don't say whether it is capital or inputs. I simply say motor vehicle. A charter accountant gets his office building constructed by entering into works contract, will he get ITC?
Yes.
Like car, I also have some problem with the immovable property. If it is immovable property related, because I don't know whether you are doing business or something else in that building, so I won't give you ITC. If this is something to do with works contract, to overcome that, somebody may decide, after all, chartered accountants are smart fellows, I will buy the materials and I will give a labor contract. Now there is no works contract. I have purchased the materials, it is my materials, I have given a labor contract. Now give me GST paid on all these goods and on that labor contract. No, ultimately if it results in immovable property, I don't know what you are using it for, so I will not give you ideas. Any inputs connected with immovable property, you forget. A chartered accountant purchases stationary items from a composition supplier, will he get ITC?
No.
He will charge 1%, 2%, whatever the composition amount. But they have made one rule, for me to claim ITC, I must be in possession of a tax invoice. Tax invoice or other tax paying document. Composition is an amount, it is not a tax. A composition dealer pays the composition amount and whatever he pays is not considered as a GST. It is in lieu of the GST, he is paying some agreed amount. Therefore, if I procure stationery from a composition supplier, there is no question of availing any ITC. You take your family out for dinner, can you take ITC? Personal consumption, no ITC. Manufacturer is claiming depreciation under income tax on the entire cost of his machinery. entire cost will include even on the GST amount. What about the ITC? If GST has been depreciated, then if I give you ITC, you are claiming double benefit. Job worker, there is a special provision. In the normal course, ITC should have been denied to the person who is sending the goods for job work because he doesn't pay any tax on the supplies made to that job worker. A special provision has been made saying that he will be eligible for that ITC, but it comes with a small rider. Materials sent for job work should come back within a period of 6 months. Similarly, you can send machinery to a job worker to do work on the materials that you are sending. On such machinery, again, they could have denied, saying that when you send the machinery to that supplier, I mean job worker, you are not paying item GST, therefore we will deny. But here there is a case where they have said you will be eligible for ITC, but the condition is that that machinery should be received back within a period of 2 weeks. If it is not received back within this prescribed time, those supplies initially made will be treated as taxable supplies and you will get tax along with interest.
Job worker charge rice.
Beg your pardon?
Job worker.
He'll tax GST. That is only on that job work. We are on that, this fellow will get the ITC, no doubt. But on the materials what he has sent for job work, what happens to that GST? That is what we are looking at. I procure the materials by paying GST. Now that GST, I want to take it as ITC, but department will say you have sent this material to the job worker, you have supplied, but on that you are not paying the tax. Accommodation invoices. Actually, goods are not received, only tax invoice is received. Like I told you, this is practiced by some people to overcome this restriction of not getting a refund of ITC. I have huge amount of ITC with me, but the government will not give me refund. He has huge amount of output tax payable to the government. So I issue him one invoice, tax invoice, without actually supplying, so he will pay me the money. So I am getting a refund indirectly from the government. To stop this practice, unless the goods are actually received, ITC will not be available. Wherever there are continuous supplies, for example, this car manufacturer, they might arrange for continuous supply throughout the year. In such case, if the supplier issues the tax invoice upfront, basically to ensure that there is a commitment from the buyer, he will get the ITC only after he completes the last installment of supplies. Because it may so happen, he may take the credit, thereafter he may not supply. To overcome that kind of a situation, they have made this one. A car manufacturer in Haryana delivers goods to transporter as instructed by dealer in Bangalore. Simple. Maruti Udyog will deliver the cars to the transporter in Haryana. Because Mandovi has asked him to do, when can this Mandovi take ITC? Should he wait for the truck to reach Bangalore to receive the ITC, to take ITC, or as soon as the goods are delivered to the transporter, can he take the ITC? If it is at the instance of this person recipient, then as soon as it is delivered to the transporter, he can take the ITC. A supplier, after collecting GST, runs away without remitting that amount to the government. Can I take the ITC? This is a simple case. I have paid the tax to the supplier, he has not paid it to the government. Can I take ITC?
No.
You will not
say it is the responsibility of the government, otherwise what are you people doing? If he has not paid the ITC, go after him, collect it. Why do you make me suffer? Today there is no room for such argument. Simply the system will deny you the ITC. A supplier doesn't file his monthly return for April 2017. Can he file a return for May 2017 and claim ITC? The system has been beautifully devised in GST. Unless you file your return for a previous month, you cannot file return for the subsequent month. And the only way to claim ITC is by filing the return. It is not by giving any letter to the assessing officer. When should you take, is there any time limit for claiming ITC? I'm sure many of you must have heard about the centum industries case and all. Is there any time, when should I take? Obviously, I cannot take ITC before I receive the invoice. All of you will like it. After receiving the invoice, is there any time limit? Should I claim it within 2 months? Should I claim it within 6 months? Should I claim it within 1 year? What is the time limit? Within 1 year, we should have something new. So there is something new in GST. Before you file the return for September of a given year, you will have to file an annual return for the previous financial year. For example, let us say GST will become operational from 1st April 2017. Let us say amen. By 30th September, no, not by 30th, by 20th October 2017, you will have to file an annual return containing the details of your transaction between April 2017 to March 2017. Agreed? 18. He has to file an annual return. Now, whatever ITC is available to you between April 2017 to March 2018, you can claim before 20th October 2018. So, it could be 18 months for your ITC of April 2017. It could be 6 months for your ITC of March 2018. So the time varies from 6 months to 18 months. This is where the capital goods definition becomes little relevant. I purchase a machinery today, I start using it. I claim ITC full amount. There is nothing like 50%, 50%. At least in the model law, we do not have anything like that. After 1 year, I decide to sell it. Sell it for 50% value. Can you visualize the government is going to lose heavily? Whatever GST that you have paid on procuring, already you have got it back. When you are selling it, you are going to pay GST only on 50% of its value. Government is the loser in the process. Somebody has thought even to that extent. So what they say is, we will give you certain percentages. If you sell after 1 year, you must realize at least 85% of your original cost. If you are selling it for 50%, we don't come in your way of selling it for 50%, no problem. But you pay GST on 85%. Time for claiming the destination. Job work is on. Distribution of ITC by input service distributor. A trader has ITC in respect of GST paid on goods received in his branch in Mumbai. Can he transfer such ITC to his HO in Bangalore? What do you think? The heading suggests it is ITC in respect of services that are received, not in respect of goods. Here you are talking of transferring ITC in respect of goods. There is no distribution of ITC in respect of goods. It is only ITC in respect of services can be transferred from one branch to another. A CA firm in Mumbai has ITC in respect of GST paid on its office rent. Can it transfer it to branch in Bangalore and use it there?
Yes.
Yes.
See, when they pay the rent in Bombay, you try to understand the logic, in Bombay, they would have paid SGST to Maharashtra government, correct? If you transfer that SGST to Karnataka, what happens? A third cure. That is not possible. Services should be received in one state and corresponding tax invoice if it is received in another state, then it is possible. Within the state, you can do anything you want. But when two states are involved, this transfer gets restricted. The same IST. By the way, I think if I explain this CGST, SGST, and IGST, what is the significance? CGST means what? Tax payable to the government of India. SGST means tax payable to the state government. IGST integrated because it has the components of both CGST and SGST. Can you set off SGST against ITC of CGST? What does that actually mean? You have to pay some tax to the government. You are trying to utilize the credit that is lying with the... You are required to pay some tax to the state government. You are trying to utilize credit lying with central government. Not possible. So, SGST credit cannot be utilized to pay CGST. Similarly, CGST credit cannot be utilized to discharge your obligation under SGST. Clear? Can I use my IGST credit to pay SGST?
Sequence.
First IGST, then CGST. The sequence is understandable, but why that sequence? One is understood. First you set it off against CGST. That is, central government is the big brother. That is understandable. But why SGST is allowed, credit of SGST is allowed to be set off against your liability to pay IGST, and vice versa, credit of IGST is allowed to be utilized to discharge your liability under SGST. That is also possible. We saw that first example, Hosur case, where Ashok Leyland is procuring the goods. Imagine they had not allowed you to set off SGST and IGST. What would have happened in that case? That will answer your question. Ashok Leyland has procured the materials from the Bangalore party. Bangalore party has charged IGST. Now, if Ashok Leyland sells the goods in the state of Tamil Nadu, they have to pay CGST and SGST. You agree? To Tamil Nadu government. If Ashok Leyland is not allowed to set off SGST against IGST or CGST against IGST, Ashok Leyland would not have bought that goods from Bangalore,
yes, sir.
By creating that hurdle, they would have prevented creation of a national market. That is the reason, even though it is very cumbersome from the government perspective, or this GST network, which is supposed to be the backbone, which is doing all this transfers, everything, they have ensured that you are allowed to set off SGST and CGST against IGST, similarly IGST against SGST and CGST. The only restriction is SGST cannot be set off against CGST, CGST cannot be set off against SGST. Once you understand that, it becomes very easy. Utilization of IDC, yeah. Now, an order imposing penalty and charging interest has been passed against a supplier. Can he pay them by utilizing ITC? ITC can be used only to discharge your GST liability, not interest or penalty. Interest and penalty can be, has to be paid only by cash or whatever bank transfer. It will come in that e-cash ledger. Setting of PFC, refund of ITC. General rule, no refund. Exceptions, two exceptions they have provided. One is if you are exporting the goods, those exports are called as zero rated, and you can claim the refund of that ITC. Again, this refund is given only as an incentive. There are certain goods which are subjected to export duty when they are exported. What does that mean? We really don't encourage you to export those items. For example, I think I am poor. So wherever goods are subjected to export duty, you will not get refund of it. Second case, we will have to see which are the circumstances where the rate of tax on your inputs is much higher than the rate of tax on the outputs that are produced by using those inputs. Obviously, you will have a case of excess ITC. That the government face, we will give it back to you. When should somebody apply for refunds? It is 2 years from the relevant date. This relevant date has to be read in the context. For example, when it is export, that period starts from the time the goods are loaded onto the ship. From that day you compute 2 years period. Next, transitional provisions. Do you have to apply afresh when the GST is enacted? No. Your existing registration will automatically get changed to registration under GST. But initially they say it is going to be provisional. You may have to furnish certain details. Why that provisional registration becomes important? Because all this ITC and all that thing will have to be credited to your account. So you need that registration.
Even service tax registration will be
automatic. Yes. We call it, there are several earlier laws which will be subsumed in this GST. Now you are going to have an enactment called Central GST Act, Excise Act, Finance Act 1994, the act under which the additional duty of customs is levied. All these enactments are going to get merged with this. Similarly, under the SGST Act, your VAT law, octroi, entry tax, I think entertainment tax, luxury tax, all these acts are going to get merged with that. So if you have registration under that, automatically you are given registration under GST. Who are the officers with whom you are going to interact? Will you have a new set of officers or the existing officers can go home and say, from today onwards I am a GST officer. What happens to your existing CELMAT credit or ITC which you have claimed in the return and which is carried forward? You will not lose it. It will automatically become ITC under your GST regime. There might be cases where you might not have claimed this credit. For example, when it comes to capital goods under excise law, you claim 50% in the first year, balance 50% in the following year. That 50% what you have not claimed, you can start claiming in the new regime. You were under composition scheme under VAT, now you are coming under GST. You can straight away go to the normal scheme. The tax paid on the stock that is lying will be allowed as ITC under the GST regime. Refund claims under earlier law will be granted. Yes, nothing will be lost. I mean, that's how you have to take it. Nothing will be lost. Only thing, there is some time limit that is prescribed if you have not made the claim, because it cannot be kept open eternally. Normal time limit is 6 months. For example, you are entitled for refund. You have not made the claims under the old regime. Now you can make it, but within 6 months from the date of commencement. Similarly, the 6 months period is not applicable if some proceedings has to be started against you. The same time limit what is prescribed in the existing law. For example, in Finance Act, Service Tax Law, within 1.5 years or extended period of limitation of 5 years, same time limit will come apply even under the GST, so they can start the proceedings all afresh. ITC in relation to exports, imports, I think with that. Choices. So if you ask the question, I may have serious difficulty. Anyway, jokes apart, if there are any doubts which is bothering you, probably may have.
So
you're
giving permission for the audit, sir?
You can make a suggestion, which literally means there is no provision. Audit is there. The question is, whether by chartered accountants or by the departmental officials. I think that is your question. Right? Right now, there is no such thing which is earmarked for chartered accountants.
Who will be the jurisdictional officer in GST? What are the answers?
A big fight is going on, because initially it is proposed that up to 1.5 crore turnover, it is going to be the state officers. Above that, it is going to be the excise and service tax officers. So a big fight is going on, because state level officers are simply not comfortable.
First about
beg your pardon? No basic exempt. Moment you get registered, you become a taxable person liable to pay the tax.
From 1 rupee?
No. From the date you procure the registration.
So the turnover is 11 lakhs. As soon as the 9 lakhs exceed, we apply our.
The moment your turnover, any turnover after the 10 lakhs,
yeah,
you become liable.
Okay.
For the first 10 lakhs, you are not liable. So that is if you have applied in the normal course. That is, the moment you have touched a turnover of 9 lakhs, if you have applied for registration, then for that 1 lakh, that is till you reach 10 lakhs, you don't pay tax. Which also means that up to 10 lakhs, you don't pay. But thereafter, you will continue.
Next question is, a person is PR registered under KVA. Next month, we apply for generation registration. Can we ask a transition relief for settled asset in red book?
Now, come again, you are under?
A person, we are the trader. We
have
VAT number. In November or December 16, we apply for settled asset registration. Can we ask a transition relief stock on day on 31st March 2017, excise and VAT both was triggered.
Yes, of course.
But we have not filed the settlement excise for a monthly for a month. We have filed 16 onwards. And Mr. We apply for residue.
No, it is not only applied, it is with the reference to the goods that are lying on that date, that is the cutoff date.
Right, but we have not submitted.
That's what it, in fact, it goes to the extent of saying, even if you are unregistered dealer under the present law, you have some stock on 31st March 2017, you apply for registration. On that stock, you get the ATC.
Yes, sir, we have the government has to pay 25 or 30%. Because
VAT
is 14%, maybe excise is
17%, 19%. The issue is, you said government has to pay. Government
more,
will not pay, they will credit it to your account.
But we will get.
Because that is something you have already paid.
But we have not submitted the return.
That doesn't take away the fact that you have paid that tax to the government. But and that goods are still lying in you.
I asked the seller, officer. He said no, because you are intentionally to apply for it, so only for IDC, you have not submitted the return from the
There is a specific transitional provisions which deals with persons who are not registered under the earlier law. So, ladies and gentlemen, yes, please. Beg your pardon?
Yes.
Why are you having that doubt? They are not singling out chartered accountants, only I singled him out. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Can you please be seated for a few more minutes? I will not take much of your time. So, we had a fantastic session, very lively, and with apt humor example, I think you made an otherwise an excellent presentation for an outstanding one. Please give him a crowd of applause. Time to present a memento on behalf of ITC, Indirect Tax Committee of ICAI, and on behalf of Bangalore branch of SAS of ICAI, may I request CA Anirham to come forward and present a memento to the speaker as a token of appreciation and gratitude. Thank you, CA Anirham. So, my wholehearted thanks to each one of you for your active participation. And last but not the least, please thank our Bangalore branch staff for their dedicated service. Thank you very much.